When it comes to securing Pi the best it can be secured, well, you'll notice that a lot of what the discussion is about closing off things that we used to do. So this is one of those instances where if you're just implementing Pi for the first time, you're in luck. All of the recommendations we have are going to go much easier for you since you don't have any of our legacy mechanisms for doing security. But basically, what we're going to suggest you do is to make sure you disable any explicit logins using the regular username and passwords or the traditional user and passwords from Pi. Don't allow any users under any circumstances to use piadmin or to map to the Pi user called piadmin. Instead, we suggest you create a new identity, and we'll go over that. We'll suggest you create identities and trusts for interfaces that have the proper write access. In other words, we've relied too heavily on just using piadmin as a general connection that can write to everything. But we suggest that when working with interfaces, you don't do that, and we'll go over that. Also, we suggest you disable PyWorld. I'll show you where to do that in the database. We suggest you secure all of your utilities with something called Check Utility Login. And finally, we suggest you disable SDK-based trusts. A lot of this discussion is going to be around how to kind of back off some of the earlier implementations of Pi security. And of course, when you do that, you want to do it in a way that doesn't disable anybody who's currently connecting. And that can be tricky. That's why we don't attempt to do this automatically for you. We've been looking at this Pi server security document because this is where, I guess, our best recommendations can be found. You'll find that on our tech support website. The first recommendation is to disable explicit logins. And what you'll notice is that's something that actually shows up by default when you install the Pi server. It's one of the options is to disable the password authentication for Pi users. See, since we've gone to Windows Integrated Security, there's really no need anymore to use the traditional Pi user and password. So that's something we suggest you do initially when you install, if this is a brand new installation, not if it's an upgrade, though, because if it's an upgrade, disabling that may hurt your existing users. If you need to disable users, or in order to disable users like that, the explicit Pi users, what you would do is go into this security settings here, under Pi SMT. So we're running Pi SMT under security settings. It's this right here that we're going to disable, this explicit login disable. And that will disable the traditional Pi users and passwords you may have configured. Again, go slowly when doing this. This isn't something that you're going to want to do without giving a lot of consideration to people who may already be using that. It's not something I would do, 3 o'clock on a Friday. You may want to do this, for example, during a planned maintenance shutdown anyway. So just not at a time where people are going to be greatly inconvenienced if you accidentally disable them from logging into Pi. Now, what's it mean if you do disable them from logging in using their traditional user and password? Well, it means that before you do that, you'd better have the alternative ready. And the alternative is what you'll find described in our other videos on Windows Integrated Security. So that's what we suggest you do first. And basically, this means all connections to Pi from users should be done using Windows Integrated Security. Again, my apologies to those of you who have been with us for a long time and you've got all this infrastructure built in with all these other mechanisms to connect. You know, it's like that with high-tech stuff. The last guy in tends to be the guy who has the easiest road here. And if you've just bought Pi for the first time, you implement Windows Integrated Security from the start, it's going to be a lot easier than somebody who's migrating forward. The latest and greatest stuff tends to be better than the stuff that came before it, and not just by a little bit. Now, what's implicit in this suggestion is that we suggest you no longer use this Pi user called piadmin. We suggest you don't use that user for anything anymore. Instead, we suggest you create a new identity, like this one right here, Pi Supervisors. This is an identity that's associated with the, having some kind of supervisory permissions. You would set that up as an identity. You would map it using whatever mappings, will map the people who are Windows users who should have access to this. You would go ahead and set up your mapping to Active Directory group who are supervisors. And then once those Windows users are associated with this Pi Supervisors, then under the database security, you would just make sure that all of the things that the piadmin user had access to, So for example, if you look at piadmin, he has read-write access to the point database. Okay. You just make sure that PySupervisors has that same read-write access. So in the attempt to, you know, kind of get away from using PyAdmin at all, you would use this PySupervisors or some other identity of your own choosing. So I'll go ahead and create that. And I'll go through, and for all of those databases, really all of the databases that you see here, you know, the digital state database, etc., all of these, you're going to add that PySupervisors. And then that would be what you would use instead of the PyAdmin that has traditionally been used to grant access to all these different databases. Now, another thing we suggest is to make sure that when you're configuring trusts, you configure those trusts so that they connect with identities that are other than PyAdmin. Let me show you what I'm talking about. And I have to confess, we're kind of guilty of this, of making this recommendation in our training. If you look at some of our training material, we tend to make shortcuts sometimes when we create interfaces and the trusts that go with those interfaces. We make shortcuts by just configuring a trust that maps to this PyAdmin user. And in fact, sometimes we'll even, you'll see our field service folks will do this just to get things working, and then they'll later on tighten up security. So that's not really the best practice. We don't suggest you should use a trust that connects and gives you the privileges of PyAdmin, because PyAdmin can do everything. So if somebody happens to get on that machine that's running an interface and the trust is not secure enough, you may end up having somebody who can get access in ways that you don't want. So what we suggest instead is that you explicitly configure a Py identity that is just for that interface. Now, we actually do that in the videos you'll find in this particular series of system management. You'll find that in configuring the OPC interface, we did tighten up security eventually. We created an identity called PyOPCInt, and then we ensured that PyOPCInt had privileges, only privileges required, which is the privilege to write to the tags that are collected by the OPC interface. So make sure you've created that identity, and then when you create the trust, here's our trust right here, PyOPC interface, make sure that you're associating that trust with that identity, not with the PyAdmin user. Now, one more thing we suggest is that if you really want a secure system, go ahead and disable this PyWorld identity. Now, those of you who just saw our video on Windows Integrated Security may say, hey, hold on a second, didn't we just demonstrate that because this PyWorld identity exists, that's why any Windows user who is mapped to any identity can see the system? And that is correct. That's traditionally been how people connect to Py. But if you want it to be more secure than that, if you want to only allow access based on named identities and specifically allowing or disallowing access to each and every one of the objects within Py, all the different points, then you might want to consider disabling this PyWorld identity. Just go in here and choose to disable that. So again, it's not something you should do casually. Just give a lot of consideration before disabling PyWorld. And again, don't do it during a period where it's going to inconvenience a lot of people if you happen to get it wrong and need to scramble a little to get people access. Now, another recommendation is to use what we call the check utility login setting. This is under operation and the tuning parameters. You'll notice a tuning parameter called check utility login, and what this does is it requires that people will have to log in when they use any of the command line utilities. See, right now the assumption's always been if you're at the command line on the Py server, then being at the command line basically means you're king of Py, you can do whatever you want within the Py system. This will change all that. This will require explicit login. So before you can do any one of these interactive console utilities like PyConfig, PySetPass, etc. It does require a system startup in order for that to take effect. You would just go in there and change that value to a 1. Now, if you've been working with Py for a while, you know that If you create trusts for allowing SDK-based applications to connect to Pi, you actually have better credential checking than if you create a trust that's based on the API. But even though the SDK-based trusts are stronger than the traditional trusts, the API-based ones, they're still not as strong as the Windows Integrated Security. So what we do suggest is you go into your system settings under security and you disable that. Now it does mean that now explicitly you're going to have to make sure that you've got all those things that do need to connect are connecting using Windows Integrated Security, not these trusts that are set up for SDK-based applications. So any interfaces that are connecting using the SDK, any user applications connecting using the SDK, you're going to have to make sure you set up Pi identities that will allow the connection based on the Windows Integrated Security, you know, and based on the Windows user that maps to those Pi identities. Now, since I mentioned interfaces and starting those interfaces and using Windows Integrated Security, I feel obliged to remind everybody how you would go about doing that for a service. I'm over on an interface node right now, and I'm running the little services applet. Let me bring that onto my screen here. In the services applet, you would just specify the logon as option for your interface. So for example, here's my OPC interface. If I go in here to the logon section, this is where I would specify a specific Windows user that would be associated with this service when it starts up. So this is where you would specify the Windows user whose credentials we're going to use in Windows Integrated Security to, you know, associate this incoming connection with a specific Pi identity that has the proper permissions. So again, in summary, a lot of what the Titus security involves is really just kind of eliminating some of the security options that you had in previous versions of Pi. Starting with Windows Integrated Security is probably the best way you could get started if you're just brand new to Pi. So hopefully you won't have to back off of a lot of things. If you are backing off of a lot of previous mechanisms for connecting, one of the things I suggest is go into the piadmin user itself that was used so much over the years for people to be granted access to Pi, that if you were to go in here and start turning off some of these things, turning off its use in a trust, not allowing anybody to create a mapping that maps to it, etc., you know, that would be a good way to ensure that you are definitely not using piadmin for any of the things that, the piadmin should no longer be used for, like allowing it to be used in an interface trust or allowing people to explicitly log on as that piadmin user, or likewise to map to that piadmin user, because he just has too many privileges.